You know, I'm going to give you a history lesson.
We got some dumbass motherfuckers floating around this country.
Stop laughing!
And when I do, start fucking.
Also, y'all did some nasty-ass jokes on my ass, too.
Funny jokes and unfunny jokes come out of the same birth.
You fucking guys are unbelievable.
Why are you laughing?
Evening, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Why Are You Laughing? A History of Comedy podcast. Today, not live from the Vaulted Podcast Studios, but instead, we're on StreamYard. And today, I'm pleased to introduce to you celebrities attempting stand-up and, of course, our lovely guest, Royce Lopez. What's up, buddy?
Lovely. Hey, what's up, guys? I am not lovely. I'm high, but I'm good.
I try to do a professional intro. I try to be a broadcaster when I do
this. I tried like 12 years ago. I'm done doing that now. It's a lot of effort. I don't hit the post on purpose now. I don't care. Like it used to care. Like I got into all this shit, like, because I really like talk radio, like really into it. Like I loved it. Like, you know, I used to listen to Opie and Anthony. I actually fucking helped Anthony set up a stupid first compound show.
No shit. That's actually, I found you guys. Cause when Anthony got fired, my YouTube algorithm was basically all, fucking stand with Ant content.
Yeah.
And I started getting your guys' videos. Revenge of the Sis, by the way, is the podcast.
Yes. Yeah. And I don't know, man. It's just like, and I used to like, all professional and hit the post. And now every content creator is like calling every one of those a pedophile and they want to fight each other in real life. I'm like, so why am I trying so hard? And they're making millions of dollars and I'm over here fucking hitting the post and being professional for what?
Well, listen, not all pedophiles are making millions of dollars. We also have this podcast where you can find on blindmike.net, all our links, patreon.com/blindmike, support the show. But also support Revenge of the Sis. Cause like I said, I found you guys cause you talk about a lot of the same topics that we do. And we started getting into it a little bit about Stuttering John before the show, who is, this will be coming out a couple weeks after we're recording, but we'll talk about it more on the Blind Mike Project. He's going after our boy Carl from WATP, and you told me he went after you as well.
Yeah, Carl's our boy. We love Carl. We've done a show a couple of times at our show. He fucking rules.
He's the best.
When Dick Masters did the road rage thing in Tampa, we hung out with him and Dick and all them. It was fun. But I'll say this: Carl's a good dude. He's very fucking funny. But yeah, Stuttering John, we're making fun of him a lot because he's Stuttering John. And it was like early days when he first started his podcast. Someone was like, hey, man, you know, Stuttering John's like doing a podcast. I mean, he's fucking doing what? And I go look at it and it's as bad as you would think. He fucking sucks. But there's a charm to how stupid he is.
Right.
So we just joked around with him. By the way, we didn't even do anything too mean. It was just general making fun of him.
Yeah.
And I get a DM from Stuttering John's account on my personal Twitter, and it's like, this is Stuttering John's lawyer. My name is blah, blah, blah. I forget his name. And I'm from the law firm of blah, blah, blah. And if you don't cease and desist, we're going to take you to court for copyright infringement. Yeah. Bah, 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 bah. And I just replied LOL to him. I was like, okay. Yes. I sent it to my lawyer. My lawyer started laughing. He's like, bro, don't even take those videos down. Fuck him. He can't do anything to you. Everything you've done is completely legal. So, you know.
I don't know. Most litigation is done via DM. I think you guys should be a little worried.
Yeah, no, I mean, lucky I didn't have AOL Instant Messenger. It might have come through an away message or something. I don't fucking know. What a little fucking carny Stuttering John is, too. Yeah, now he's bitching because he's like, oh, these clubs won't hire me. A club in California, by the way, because I'm too progressive. Because, yeah, you know, that's what's happening. All the fucking progressive people, they're getting kicked off a platform. Oh, you're right. Oh, yeah. There's a fucking tsunami of progressive. Come on, shut the fuck up, John. All right. Well,
that's true, too, by the way. If you guys want to check out Revenge of the Sis podcast, for any of you fucks that have been calling me a liberal cuck the last few weeks, I wouldn't have this madman on. Check out his Twitter. It's a Craig wet dream. It's all guns and vaccine talk.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, dog. I don't care. I convinced a bunch of people today on Twitter that I was a fucking real doctor from Johns Hopkins University. And a bunch of people, is this true? And a bunch of people started calling Johns Hopkins, being like, is this guy really work there? Because if he does, and I was fucking crying. This guy was screaming at me, going, my cousin died of COVID and what you did's not funny. I go, I don't know. I think it's pretty fucking funny.
Craig, if you listen to Revenge of the Sis, you actually should. It's right up your alley.
I will definitely do that. If that's the topics, hell yeah.
Yeah.
Considering John Guns, COVID.
Yeah. Dude, I'm telling you, man. A lot of people are like, oh, you guys are just, you know, when we listen to our shows, like, you guys are just trying to be conservative like Crowder. I'm like, first off, Crowder fucking sucks. And secondly, and I'll say that to his fucking face, when he's wearing a dress again and pretending to be straight. those things are Crowder, you know, Crowder stuff, the whole Yale thing. Yeah. But I've always been a comedy over politics over anything, right? Like, always. Like, that to me is, I'll make fun of any. I'll make Lindsey Graham is basically a gay plantation owner. Like, I don't care, you know? Yep. Right. To me, if you're funny, I don't give a shit. Like, I've laughed at him. Look, if you're a funny guy on the left, then your Cumtown's a great example, right?
Right. Yeah, they're socialists, basically. But they're hilarious. Look, they're
fucking funny, right? Yeah. Like, I don't give a shit. Like, to me, I'm not a guy who gets into, like, oh, if I don't like your politics, I'm like, I don't give a fuck, man. Dave Chappelle's hilarious, and he does some black power shit, and I don't give a fuck because he's funny. And you know why? I'm a person who respects people that are upfront with me, right?
Right.
Like, if you come to my face and go, look, I'm a fucking commie tanky, and that's what I am, I'll be like, hey, you know what? Respect. At least you're being honest with me. What I don't like is, like, the fucking people that pretend there's something else. That's what bothers me, you know?
Yeah. And that's why we kind of have crossover topics. So, like, this show, typically we take a positive look at stand up. We break down comics from the past that we like and things like that. But when I reached out to Royce, I said, is there any topics you might find interesting? And his immediate response was, Brendan Schaub's always fun. And I was like, all right,
I'm going to help you guys out right now.
Yeah.
This is, and you guys are doing good. I've seen your channels. You guys are doing pretty well, especially for a newer show. Better than we did. Then again, we were the first year we existed, we were banned off of YouTube for 6 months because all the strikes we got.
Okay, that doesn't help. Yeah.
Yeah, they basically said we bullied and harassed Jeffrey Epstein, which is a real thing. We got a strike on my fucking mother. We got a bullying and harassment.
A nice guy. You should have left him alone. I don't understand.
Hillary should have left him alone. What was I saying? I completely forgot.
Our channel is great, you said?
Yeah, your channel. Of course he fucking remembers that.
You were banned for Epstein.
Now, help you out. If you do Brendan, that's what I was going to remember.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
If you do Brendan Schaub stuff, that's hot in the algorithm right now. You tag that bad boy, right? That video will take off. Right. So I'm just telling you, every time right now, whenever we just make fun of Brendan because it's so easy. Yeah. I clip that, put it on the clip channel, but 30,000 views. Like, and the other videos do nothing, but those just blow up because everybody likes making fun of this fucking clown.
So when Royce told me that, I was like, all right, we've done Brendan Schaub on the Blind Mike Project. We've done it on Patreon episodes. I can't again do it on Why Are You Laughing? But if we frame it like we're attacking celebrities attempting stand up, then I can kind of make it fit the format. So that's what we're doing today.
I love, man, you're right up. This show is right up my alley. Celebrities trying stand up, dude, I'm already tingling at the douche chills I'm gonna get because it's my favorite. I mean, like, so it's like when Bruce Willis tried to have a blues band. Whenever celebrities get out of their lane, it's hilarious. Yeah.
One of our first Patreon episodes was celebrities attempting music, and we got Joe Pesci.
Oh, yes, his rap.
His rap is great, but him singing What a Wonderful World might be the best piece of music of all time.
Steven Seagal's music. Really
Steven
good.
Seagal's tremendous. Really? Yeah.
It's good. It's actually good, Steven Seagal. Yeah,
it wasn't as bad as I wanted it to be, actually.
Blues singer Steven Seagal from the Bayou.
Yeah.
So let's start, Craig. I'm actually going to skip Mick. I'm going to skip the Mick Foley clips, I think.
Yeah.
So I started with Mick Foley.
I like Mick Foley. Mick Foley's funny for me because Mick Foley's a guy who I don't judge him for doing stand up because he's not really doing stand up. He's telling stories more. So yeah, I'm like, I get that. People probably want to hear his, you know, crazy shit he did in wrestling. That's, you know, so that kind of like storytelling stuff doesn't really. Right. It's kind of like what Kevin Smith used to do, right? Kevin Smith's not a stand up, but he'd sit there for 2 hours and talk about movies and shit that he did, which there's a market for that.
Yeah, there were just a couple things in the Mick Foley thing that I found funny that a lot of celebrities do. There were a lot of applause breaks based on, hey, I'm a famous guy. And hey, I'm going to say Stone Cold Steve Austin's name and get an applause.
Dude, Cheap Heat. I love, but Cheap Heat is the best. It's like, wow, I sure love being in Seattle. Like, that's, man, aren't the Supersonics? They're not there anymore, but aren't the Supersonics great?
That was one of his unique moves, wrestler.
I know, it was fucking great. I interviewed Mick Foley. I interviewed Mick Foley 7 years ago, probably.
You want to talk about a psycho liberal, that guy.
Dude, but you know, we interviewed him 7 years ago. He wasn't really didn't really talk about politics. But now all of a sudden he's now like, I'm going to leave Twitter because Elon Musk is a Nazi. And I'm like, what a weird world I live in that mankind is screaming that the Tesla guy is a Nazi. And it's going to be Twitter. I'm like, a lot of people get angry because I used to get mad. And now like we're through the looking glass and you have to laugh at everything. Dude, the absurd things that have been happening. Like, I really believe in the Matrix theory, which is 1999 was the peak of human civilization. Yeah. After that, I don't know, man. Limp Bizkit caused 9/11, and now we're here.
We peaked in high school. We peaked years ago, 100%. And now we're fucking wasting away.
You're right, man. Now you're just like, I don't know, man. I guess it's a new Star Wars.
But yeah, but like I said, Mick Foley, like, he had good stage presence. Like you said, he was a good storyteller. He just did a couple of those things that bugged me. But if you want to start with a real bad one that I think we'll have fun with, we should go to the T.I. clips. Okay. Are you aware that he has started stand-up?
No, and then thank you. I'm so excited. Now, T.I. the rapper.
Yes, yep. T.I. Okay. the rapper. Now, to tie it into our boy, Brendan Schaub, to tie it into everything we've talked about, I guess, I was on WATP a couple months ago. And we did The King and the Sting and the Wing, which is Schaub, D'Elia, and Theo Vaughn.
Yes.
And I sent Carl a clip where Brendan Schaub says, did you guys hear T.I. is doing stand-up? And kind of rolls his eyes like, what? These douchebag celebrities that just get on stage because of their name, right, everyone?
You know, and he is that out of touch, bro. I know, and people laugh. He's that out of touch. Like, he does that shit all the time. Like, I remember when the whole Shane Gillis thing happened with SNL, where they didn't hire him because he did an Asian accent or whatever. Right. And I remember watching an episode of Fighter and the Kid on our show, a clip of where Brendan Schaub's like, you know, I get it, man. Like, the Asian community is going to be upset at that, like, taking SNL's side. And then I just remember his fucking first special when he was doing the Asian UFC doc. Like,
Don't spoil it, Royce.
Don't spoil it. We're going to get there.
Okay, sorry, I apologize.
But first, let's hear T.I. taking the stage. This is so he's been getting a lot of shit from comedians for the same thing I just said about Brendan Schaub. Mm-hmm. A lot of actual comics, and mostly open micers, I'm sure, are bitching that T.I. is getting stage time. And so he kind of addresses that here and then gets into some other stuff.
I think, the shit... What's odd to me is the motherfuckers hate to see me up here on stage telling my life, sharing my experiences, getting laughs.
You pull that room is laughing so much.
Oof. He goes, you're supposed to laugh there.
They hate to see that shit. But they have no problem seeing me in prison, though.
Well, hold on. Here's why, though. Here's why, because you being in prison would actually be funny.
It really would.
I would laugh way harder.
The premise doesn't make any sense. He's acting like, who was laughing at him for being in prison? No one was like, this is great, man. This is good material.
You go ahead. Sorry.
I was going to say, there's nothing worse than a comic going and doing a thing, building up for that expected joke laugh to go with them, and they stay silent. You're supposed to laugh there.
It's the worst. It's the best for me. Like, I love comics bombing, but it's his you go, you guys were laughing. Like, because I would wake up in the morning and just giggle to myself when he was in prison. I'd be like, today's a bad day, but at least I'm not T.I. and just start giggling.
Oh, you remember T.I.'s in prison? That's kind of funny.
You know, inflation is crazy right now. I can't afford gas, but T.I.'s in prison, so at least I'm not him.
Well, that's why it's a bad idea for a lot of these people to get into stand-up, because they're so out of touch with reality. Mm-hmm. I mean, like, we've debated before, like, if Eddie Murphy came back, would he be funny? Because he's been famous for so long, he's got to be completely out of touch. Like, would he be able to relate to people? And then you could say he could do material about that because he's a very talented comedian. T.I. is both working against him because he is a completely untalented comedian who has lost touch with reality.
Yeah, man, it's what happens with celebrities. Like,
I think they get bored, you know, and they're like, oh, I could do anything. You know, I'm multifaceted. And then you're like, no, you're not. Like, you're not going to be a comedian. You know, right. Brendan Schaub, maybe you could have been a comic, but that before you got punched 150 times in your brain, you know, like in a it really it's a weird ego thing, right? It's like when you become like T.I., you're probably surrounded by people that always tell you, yeah, man, everything you do is awesome and you're great. Right. And obviously those people are getting money off of you. So they're not going to want to be like, hey, man, you kind of fucking suck, you know, because they'll be like, no, man, T.I., your set was great, Mo. There's the honkies didn't know what they were doing, to use an old racial term, I guess.
Sure. It's the greatest, though, because like he does the Jeb Bush thing there where he's like, you guys are supposed to clap here. Come on.
Please clap.
But there's a clip I didn't include where he's in front of what I assume is his audience, like more of a rap audience, because he comes out and does stand up and they just boo him mercilessly. They're like, what the fuck is this?
Good. These people need to be humiliated. These motherfuckers got so cocky, they sang Imagine like it was going to fix the world. All these fuckers should be shamed every day of their life.
And what they don't realize, this is why I actually respect like the guys that try this, like Steve-O. Because Steve-O got into like comedy and started playing clubs and shit, but he'll staple his nuts to his leg and light himself on fire. He knows he's Steve-O.
I like, you know what Steve-O. I mean? Steve-O's a humble dude, believe it. How crazy is, every time I see Steve-O, he's a nice guy. He's not arrogant. Like, you can never go, Steve-O's so, Johnny Knoxville kind of is, but Steve-O's more, you know, like, yeah, man, you know, whatever. Like, I got lucky, you know, I had drug problem. I don't anymore. And I did crazy shit. And now I just, you know, I want to tell my stories. And you're like, oh yeah, I can respect that. It's the same thing with me. Like Theo Von. Theo Von's a dude. Like, I like Theo Von, right? Mm-hmm. Some people are like, oh yeah, all these people, all the LA comics suck. And a lot of them do. But someone like Theo Von was like, yeah, man, you know, I'm just doing my thing. You know, like he's like the Joe Dirt to me. Right. Where he's like, I'm just hanging out here, man. You're just making my money with my mullet. And I'm like, all right, you know, I kind of like the guy. I think the sincerity has a lot to do with it. I think you could say that with T.I. or with Schaub or with anybody that gets that famous. They don't understand. They've lived so long being in this bubble that they can't fathom when they go into another space that people aren't going to be like, who the fuck are you parking in the front of the comedy club when I've been working here for 10 years, you know?
Right. And they have no concept that it takes 10 years for very funny people to get good at stand-up.
Of course.
You know what I mean? Like, Shane Gillis got successful when he was 33, 34 years old, and he's like a wunderkind. He's hilarious at a very young age. Like, most guys, and he was doing stand-up for 12 years. You know what I mean? Yeah. And that's considered fast track. Like, I listen to, I don't know if you listen to Joe List at all, who I think is an incredibly underrated stand-up.
I do know Joe List, yes.
And his movie trailer just came out, and he said one of the comments was like, Joe List kind of came out of nowhere. And Joe was like, I've been doing comedy for 22 years. Like, I'm not some fucking, some fresh-faced kid in comedy. Like, he's technically young compared to, you know, when Bill Burr got famous or whatever. But he's a 39-year-old guy, and people just look at it as like, he came out of nowhere, you know?
You know who else is like that? Ian Fidance. He's another dude that's like just kind of now taking off.
Yeah.
But he was one of those. He's been doing this for a really long time. You know what I mean? And I think that I think with comedy is unlike like other things like sports and stuff. When you want to, you're at your peak when you're young in basketball or football. I think comedy is something like you really don't start peaking until you do it for a while, you know, until you actually build it up. And I think, you know, like the shop again, going back to Schaub, T.I., all of them, it's like, I think it's like, I have you ever seen any comedian get a Showtime special after 1 year of doing stand-up? Like,
it's wild,
right? That's the part where I'm not a stand-up, right? But that's the part where even I'm mad. I'm like, how fucking dare you, you know? Like, there's some people out there that are fucking, people that I know that are fucking million times funnier that are never going to get that shot, you know, because we're giving it to Brendan because he's friends with Joe Rogan. And I think that's what it is. It's because I don't even dislike Joe Rogan. I'll be honest. I've always said it. I don't really like Joe Rogan stand up. It's not for me.
Okay.
You know, I
didn't like his early stuff. I liked his last two specials.
Yeah. That's just for me. But I think, but I like Rogan as what he does. I think Rogan is a better podcaster than a stand up guy. Sure. Obviously he's the biggest podcast in the fucking world. Right. But I think this is a situation where if we're being honest about this, it was because he's Rogan's friend. Like, there's literally no other reason that somebody would get those breaks.
Right. Completely. And I mean, I've said, me and Craig have talked about this a bunch, where if Showtime came to me and said, hey, Mike, we're going to give you $500,000 or, you know, $3 million or whatever the number is for an hour special, I would say I'll gladly take it. But I would have to do that knowing it's going to be shit, because I've never performed stand-up. I've never been on TV before. There's no reason I should have that. So I would gladly take it, but I would have to do that knowing I'm going to get shit on. And I think that's the worst part about what you're seeing from T.I. here, or what we'll talk about Schaub later, is when they do get shit on when they first start, they're like, why is this happening? Because it's never happened to them before.
No, you're right. I mean, it's people that I won't say Schaubing. I'll even use T.I., right? Let's use T.I. as an example. So we're going to just talk about Schaub. We'll talk about Schaub later. T.I. is a great example of this, where it's like, I think there's no way to be a good comic and also have self-esteem. I really believe that. And I think the funniest people in the world hate themselves. And I think anybody that knows any comic, comics will tell you this. Like, this isn't like, you know, they hate themselves in some way.
Right.
And I know that sounds existential, but that is something. Like, T.I. doesn't hate himself. T.I. fucking loves himself. Right. You know? Like,
which is great, yeah. Good for you, but just know that you don't have that.
If great for a rapper, great quality for a rapper, to love yourself, flossing, you know, I get it. Right. But to be a good comic, like, you have to have a sense of nihilism, right? You have to have a sense of everything is fucked up and or whatever. And you're sure you'll get rich and maybe that goes away. But I think that that's kind of what motivates you to be funny. If you name the funniest people in the world, right? That Louis C.K. to me, only because Norm Macdonald died, Louis C.K. to me, I think, is the funniest living comedian right now. Sure. Probably close second, Dave Chappelle, right?
Right.
That's what I think. And these guys, if you read about them and see what they are, they fucking hate themselves, you know? Right. Watch fucking Louis on FX and not think he's suicidal, right? Like, I'm like,
Chappelle, I would say less so now.
Of
which
course.
Is why I think his last couple specials have been less funny.
Yeah. No, agreed. And I think that comes and that happens to everybody. I mean, even Carlin. Carlin's later specials, we gave him a break because he was Carlin, but Carlin's last two specials weren't that great, you know? But he's George Carlin, you know? Yeah.
They were great philosophical speeches more than comedy specials.
Yes. You know what they would have been? They didn't have him at the time. Great TED Talks.
Yes. Yeah, exactly.
Great TED Talks. Because he's smart. What he said was right, but
brilliant, yeah.
Did I laugh as hard as you know, as some other, like when Louis did his joke on fucking abortion? Of course not, you know?
Right. All right, let's finish this clip. Go back a little bit, Craig, and then we'll see how he handles this topic. And then I believe we end with a brilliant transition that really shows you these comedy chops.
Oh, yes.
Prison dope. That shit's like, oh, yeah, that fits. Yes, yeah, that's right. You weren't supposed to laugh that hard just there. That's cool. I ain't gonna trip. I mean, you know, I'm gonna work through it. I'm gonna work through it. And if anybody knows anything about me, you know, there's a such thing as the king of the South that I invented. Yeah. And the thing about it is, the king of the South shit didn't mean as much to me as it did when motherfucker said that I couldn't have it. Exactly how I feel about comedy.
I'll play the next clip, because the next clip is much more. That's what I was thinking of.
What a fucking asshole. What a smug fuck this guy is, huh?
He's bringing up, and that's, it goes back to what you were saying a second ago. He's bringing up, he's inventing hardships. He's inventing the fact that we were laughing at him when he was in jail and that we hated when he called himself the king of the South. Maybe people in the rap community did, but it's certainly not the audience that he's talking to here, because they're like, what the fuck do you mean?
Would it kill him to prepare even a little?
What's that?
Yeah. So would it kill him to prepare even a little bit?
Yes, it would. He has to roll blunts all day and stuff. Look, if you're going to be a black comic, that's the problem. If you're going to be a black comic and you talk like this, you have to have a catchphrase like hamburger or something like that. You know,
Chucky Ducky,
quack, quack. He should do that. He should, like, you know, be like dirty, dirty South after every joke, you know?
It would be great if T.I. did that and never, never addressed that he was T.I. or anything. Like, he does Shucky Ducky Quack Quack and then goes and raps, and the two are like different characters that he plays.
Yeah, like Childish Gambino and
Donald Glover, right?
Yeah, exactly.
The next clip is what I was thinking of, where it ends with one of the great transitions that a lot of comedians could learn from.
This is all I do. No, this is all right. I ain't gonna lie to you, man. Usually it's music and lights and weed. Like, this is all right. Y'all motherfuckers looking at me, ass full of expectations, not knowing what to expect, hoping I just throw out a big word arbitrarily. If anybody don't understand some of the words that I'm saying, as the ambassador of big words, I just ask that you raise your hand and let me know. I'll come to you and we'll talk about it sometime throughout the show. Let's not hold up everybody else's good time, just, you know. But how many of y'all motherfuckers out there married?
What the fuck? Where did that segue come from? What the fuck was that? Anyway, what's the deal with airplane food?
How many of y'all marry?
I'm going to start doing that for no reason. In the middle of a topic, I'm going to be like, anyway, how many of y'all married?
To go back to like Def Jam Comics, speaking of Cumtown earlier, they introduced me to some guy that just walks on stage. He was like a Def Jam comic. Mm-hmm. He walks out on stage and he just goes, how many of y'all like sex? And the crowd goes wild. Like, what a fucking segue.
We're pretty smart, though. Everyone likes sex.
He's right.
It's that cheap heat again, you know, again.
Yeah, Craig was right, too. There was zero prep that went into this. He's like, oh, I'll throw out the word arbitrarily. No one will know what that means. And it's like,
by
no,
the way,
got
that's
it.
Not even that big of a word, you fucking retard.
It's like, a 40-cent word.
I know. Arbitrarily is what he thinks a big word is? What does he think a small word is?
He's also saying the crowd's dumb, too, because he's like, if you don't know what I'm saying, I'll come tell you. I'll walk out there.
Yeah, he's putting himself way above the crowd.
Yeah, because when I think of just like these big brain philosophers, you know what comes to my mind, right? Like, I go like, yeah, Nietzsche, what, wow. And then T.I., you know, all of these like brilliant thinkers of our time.
Plato.
I might be skipping around, Craig. Just be prepared to skip some of these, because I can tell... I'm loving having Royce on right now, and I can tell the Brendan Schaub thing is going to take us 45 minutes to get through.
Well, this is great, because I did pull up T.I.'s philosophy book. Let me read one of the passages. Ready?
Oh, please, yes.
This is Steve. Ready? I got my 44 and my dro on my Chevy on 24s and my hoe. Now where am I supposed to go? I got my 44 and my dro and my Chevy on 24s. See what I mean? Like, guy's pretty brilliant, you know?
Very similar to a mind like Richard Pryor, I would say.
Right, right, right. Except I wish this guy would set himself on fire.
Do it. The next guy I have in line is Rob Schneider.
Oh, Schneider.
So Rob Schneider doesn't totally fit the category we're talking about, because he did start in comedy and in stand-up. He got away from that and became like a catchphrase actor, where, you know, you had people's quoting "You can do it" and making copies and all that shit.
Making copies.
So
copies.
So I do feel kind of bad for Schneider, because I remember like he had a radio appearance in Florida years ago, where he was promoting some gig, like a local gig, and he was just really rude to the radio guys, and they were like, what the fuck, man? Like, we're trying to help promote you. But it seems like he has this defense mechanism of, you must be making fun of me because I'm Sandler's bitch. Like, no matter what people say to him, he has those walls up. And he even has a bit where he's listing the net worths of his friends. He's like, Chris Rock is worth $120 million. David Spade's worth $30 million. It's like, why are you focused on that, man? Just do your act.
And he had like a show on Netflix not too long ago called Rob or whatever.
Yeah.
And I actually tried to watch it. I watched like a couple episodes and like the show sucked. His wife in it is hot, though.
Oh, yeah. They find a funny way of doing that, Royce.
Yeah, it's almost like they like him because of his money and stuff, you know?
It's weird.
Yeah, when I don't think women are like that.
Yeah, when I watch Grown Ups, I'm like, yeah, Adam Sandler could get Selma Hayek, definitely.
Yeah, sure. when I watch Grown Ups, I think, man, I wish the fucking a movie studio would pay me to go on vacation with my friends. That seems like fun. I want to go to Hawaii.
I like that both of you are watching Grown Ups for some reason.
Well, I mean, how am I supposed to come? Checkmate, sir.
Fair enough.
That's a great point.
But play the second Rob Schneider clip, because I have one of his stand up. It's
something nobody has ever said or will ever say again, by the way.
He has a special out on Netflix. He mailed it in. It's like 40 minutes. He does very generic material about getting older and being married. And it's all the hits that you've heard 10 million times. But the one unique thing he did is close his special by having his daughter come out. Are you aware that his daughter is the one-hit wonder L. King, the singer?
No, but...
She sang that X's and O's song?
Oh, wait a second. That's his daughter?
Yes, that is his daughter.
That X's and O's song?
Yep.
Really?
So that one. He ends his special like this. It needs no more setup than that. He ends his special like this.
I like that.
Ladies and gentlemen, I have it. Treat for you, but more really a treat for me, the one and only my daughter L. King.
He's trying to fuck her.
Is it kind of a special Asian mama, or what was that, something Mexican kids? Really,
it said,
was that really the title? Asian mama Mexican, yeah, Rob Schneider, Asian mama Mexican kids, buddy, come on.
It's very heavy on my wife is Mexican.
Pico de gallo.
What a wacky world that. Can you imagine being married to someone who isn't the same ethnicity as you?
It's crazy. What, this Jim Crow guy was wrong now, I think.
Imagine doing a 30-minute YouTube special on that topic.
Oh, imagine doing a 25-minute special on that topic and having to do five takes.
To be fair, imagine doing an hour podcast on that special like we did. But
excuse me, sir. 2 hours for me.
Okay, good.
I don't know. Shame.
Actually, okay, so we're paused at the perfect place here. Royce, what do you predict happens next?
I mean, I'm assuming she's going to go out there and sing.
Okay, that's an interesting take.
Well, I mean, I'm just thinking, like, there's a pianist on fucking stage.
Yeah.
Sure.
The X's and O's bitch, his daughter walks up, whatever her name is, and I'm assuming...
She might sing eventually. Let's hear what happens.
If she tells stand-up, I'll kill myself on your show.
It's weirder.
Okay. All right, cool. I'm not trying to be dramatic or anything.
Okay.
Do you have that voice the whole time?
Kind of.
Nice dad sweater, Rob.
Yep, he's making out with his daughter.
Yeah, that happens sometimes. At least in my Pornhub searches.
I used to be Rob.
This is a category.
L. King's dad. And, I love you.
I like that Rob Schneider's audience is psyched for that.
To be fair, I'm surprised if Rob Schneider has a fucking audience, bro.
This is his one.
Oh, she's so ugly.
Well, I don't know.
She looks like Rob Schneider's daughter.
I was just gonna fucking say that.
I think these two bonding right now. Craig is in his element with Royce on the show.
This is great. We have the same microphone and everything.
We sure do. Killing it.
Yep.
I'll take it. James Carroll
is my daughter.
Candid colored clown they call the Sandman.
No. 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 Fuck you. Why are you ruining my name?
Just to sprinkle stardust.
I'm going to bring this good singer out to watch me do it.
She brought out his daughter who's a singer, and he's singing to her?
Couldn't you have ever imagined if I told you Rob Schneider gets a Netflix special, once you pick up your jaw, he's got a Netflix special, He ends it in song.
Tell me these aren't fuck me eyes right here. He is gonna fuck her. Look at those eyes he's giving.
Oh, look at his tongue out and everything. Yeah.
Listen, Trump started a movement where it's okay to fuck your daughters. Apparently, it's all good.
But I mean, I've seen Biden's daughter's diary, so he may have actually started it. But whatever.
It gives him a nice tussle and a hair sniff. Yeah. You know?
It's almost like all politicians are kind of pedophiles. That's weird, right?
It's weird.
Regardless of political leaning, they're all kid tuckers. They have that in common. You know what didn't have a political party line? The people that were on Epstein's plane.
It's very true.
It's a hodgepodge for sure.
Yeah, seriously.
Who do we have next before we get to Schaub, Craig?
This is definitely worth playing. This is the situation. This is one of my favorites.
Oh, no. Yeah. Well, this is a classic one.
Yeah.
So I figure we'll play that before we get to Schaub. This is a classic one that a lot of people know of, but this is probably the worst roast bombing, at least in Comedy Central history.
For sure.
The Mike, the Situation from Jersey Shore, who I actually like, I've heard him in interviews since he got out of jail. I don't mind him, but this was when he was at the peak of feeling himself. This was peak douchebaggery, and he's actually on the Trump roast. It's the roast of Donald Trump.
Oh, that's so fucking great.
So he's roasting the future president, and this is a brief clip from what is considered pretty unanimously the worst roast in Comedy Central history.
I would like to think that watching this, we're watching a future president roast a future president.
Maybe
President Mike the Situation. Hell yeah,
he's been through a lot of struggles.
Hey, I'm gonna go into my situation room.
Oh, the fun we'd have with puns.
What a douche.
Whitney, what's your deal? You look like the chicks I used to bang before I had all this money. You're a chick, right?
Okay.
On the Jersey Shore, we call ugly chicks grenades. But I actually wouldn't call you a grenade because you're not blowing up anytime soon.
He's basically just like, you're an ugly bitch.
She's treating
him. Look at that face frame. Look at that. That's hilarious.
Whitney Cummings is treating him like John Cena does in those videos when he's helping out kids. She's like, oh, it's
you. You can tell she's like, because I don't love Whitney's stand-up, but she's like a genuine comedian. So when he tries to set her up like that, she's like, he goes, you're a chick, right? And she's like, do I have to play along with your insult that's about to come to me? Like, what the fuck are you
exactly.
doing?
Exactly. I'm going to set myself up. You're a dumb cunt, right?
Okay, yes.
What's that? We're both from Jersey, and tonight's my first night doing comedy.
Oh, shit.
Burn.
It's also your last night.
This is when Jeffrey Ross still used to dress like an adult, and now he dresses like a fucking wigger. What the fuck happened to Jeffrey Ross, man?
He's literally in a Napoleon costume in this one.
Yeah, it's true. No.
A lot of people did not love the Bill Burr Presents, the special he just put out. That
bait and switch, man. That's a bait and switch. I thought it was going to be a Bill Burr special, but it was all his friends.
And I didn't love most of it, but I thought Burr was obviously the funniest one on there. And I thought the best line of the special was when he said that Jeff Ross looked like he'd been fished out of a lake. This fucking bald head and no eyebrows anymore.
He does, though.
Let's finish this up.
All right. Enough of that. All right. I see you looking at me over there, Anthony Jeselnik. I know you're a little hater, but I know you're a funny dude as well. Because the other night I told one of your super funny jokes to a supermodel, and she was laughing while I was banging her brains out with a pile of money on the floor of my motherfucking mansion.
There's so much about the. It's so wordy. It's not really an insult because he says, like, hey, I told this girl a joke of yours and she laughed. Okay.
Hey, you know what's funny? The only time Amy Schumer was ever funny is when Anthony Jeselnik was fucking her and writing her jokes for her.
Yes.
The timeline adds up, man. I have like a fucking Pepe Silva thing on my wall. I'm telling you.
It's funny. Every time Amy Schumer comes up, I say, I think Amy Schumer used to be funny, and I never correlated it with the fact that she was dating Jeselnik.
Yeah, that's why. No, but being serious, I do think Amy Schumer used to be funny, but it's only when Anthony Jeselnik was coming comedy into her.
Right.
After that, it was just just downhill.
Yeah, yes. That is how it works too. That's how I got Craig to be funny.
Mm-hmm. That's how I got HTV.
He said he's fucking.
All right, we've dilly dallied long enough here.
Ah, okay.
We've got to get to the cream of the crop because I have like 15 clips of the gringo poppy himself, Brendan Schaub.
So good.
So I want to start with this, even though it does happen within the bit that I picked. So the bit I picked is a story that I believe you've heard, Royce, but it's from not his special. I didn't pick the version from his special. I chose the version from This Is Not Happening. The show that Comedy Central stole from Ari Shaffir.
I remember that.
Which is supposed to be a show where you tell a story that you have never told on stage before. So the story that Brendan Schaub has never told on stage before was in his Showtime special. So it's an odd choice. But just to give you a little flavor, we'll get to the meat of the story later and tell you a little more about what it was about. But just to give you a little flavor and tell you who Brendan Schaub is, I sent a compilation of Brendan Schaub doing an impression of someone and who that actual person is. So Brendan Schaub is impersonating a doctor for the UFC or a physician, whatever he is, a trainer, something like that. Brendan Schaub is doing an impression, and I think it's spot on, but you can judge for yourself here.
This giant Asian doctor walks up to me and goes, "Mr. Schaub, sorry for your loss." "Thank you. That makes me feel better. Thank you for that." He goes, "But your lip."
"My name is Dr. Greg Hsu. I'm a board certified
better English than anyone on this show. This man is speaking.
Yeah, hi, this is Dr. Greg Hsu. I went to Johns Hopkins Medical Institution. I have been a therapist for 20 years, and I was born in Burbank.
If I was casting for voiceover work, if I needed a voice guy, I'd go to this guy.
Yeah, he has that like that announcer voice.
Yeah, he's almost stunningly Vader. Articulate. Almost Vader, for sure.
Accents come and go. Let's keep playing. Maybe it's not consistent the whole way through.
Right.
I take care of all the fighters as well as employees within the UFC family.
He takes out the biggest syringe you've ever seen in your life, like he's out of a goddamn comic book. Goes, "Mr. Schaub, after you numb your lip, you need many, many stitches. This be worst pain in your life, guaranteed. Worst pain in your life."
"What I enjoy the most is really seeing the rapport I have with the fighters. I've got to know them so well that they just know me now. They just know me as the doc."
You know what the worst part is? If Brendan ever fucking runs into this guy again, like, you know, like his UFC thing or something, he runs into this guy, he's going to have to look him in the eye and be like, "Ahem.
Doctor?" "Sir?"
That's the wild thing. Is like, this is a guy Schaub knows and has interacted with.
Gotta be honest, I know you did interviews.
No, I mean, like this guy's like, "Oh yeah, you know, we're gonna have to put a little numbing agent to get that." And Schaub's like, and then he was like, "A ching chong, a ding dong." I'm like, "What the fuck are you doing, bro?"
The doctor is almost annoyingly articulate to the point where I'd be like, "Dude, you don't really talk like that.
Come on, man, talk to me straight, doc."
"Give me the bad news."
And Schaub's like,
"Numb my lip, don't you?"
Schaub was like, "Oh, we had a wog dong." What the fuck, man?
It's wild. And it's also wild to take that risk in a time where doing that accent could genuinely destroy your life. Like, it could ruin your career. And you take a risk by doing an impersonation of a guy who speaks spot on
English. Bad.
The English you dream about.
Yeah, it was so bad. It's like someone going like, and you know, Barack Obama, he's like, "Yo, what up, dog?" I'm like, he doesn't talk like that. He doesn't talk like that. We've all heard the way he talks.
Yeah. That's a D's impression in Always Sunny, which is to do Obama.
Well, that was so funny. I remember that now. Yeah, it was.
So the story that Brendan Schaub is telling there that we're going to dive into, like I said, it's on This Is Not Happening, the Roy Wood years that I don't support. But he goes on to tell this story. The story he chooses is about his last fight in the UFC. And Do you know much about the UFC, Royce?
I watch it. I mean, I'm not a super fan, but I've watched plenty of them.
I don't know a ton about it, so maybe you guys can help me with how some of the rankings work and things like that, because the way Brendan Schaub starts this story makes no sense to me.
One second.
All right.
He broke up first. So there we go.
Fast forward 20 years later, I'm pursuing this exact dream in the UFC of a handful of fights under my belt, and things are good. I'm ranked top 10 in the world. I'm chilling. I'm at home. My phone rings. I don't recognize the number. It's a Las Vegas area code. Like, oh, that's interesting. I answer the phone. It's my boss. It's Dana White, president of the UFC.
Okay. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. But everything with this guy is a name drop. It was the same thing with his special. Oh, I was hanging out with Joe Rogan the other day, and I'm like, stop, man. All right. Here's the thing, man. Never name drop. Jay Moore taught me that.
Is that right?
No.
Oh, that's very impressive. Well, pish posh. I didn't realize you hobnobbed with a Jay Moore.
I love that joke because I always use Jay Moore because it's like, do people even think about that guy anymore?
It's, you know, when I think about him is, I wonder what Jay Moore is doing right now, because he used to be on top of the world.
Well, I don't call him Jay Moore in my home. We call him Nikki Cox's ex-husband.
I heard that ended like brutally, didn't
very
it?
Poorly.
Yeah, that's rough. I mean, this kind of ties into the celebrity show. Like, Jay Moore is a genuine comedian, but Jay Moore, apparently, I've never heard of this in stand up before or since. His wife, and they acknowledge this in the credits, in the press he did for it, he talked about it. He had a stand up special, I want to say Showtime, but I'm not 100% sure on the network. Yeah. But his wife wrote it for him.
Yep.
It was not his words. His wife wrote his special for him. And Jay Moore got into this thing that you see all the time. I mean, particularly in Hollywood, but now on social media, you see it a ton. Any couple that is like, I love my wife so much. She's amazing. She's the reason I wake up in the morning. You can guarantee, you can, you know, set your watch by their divorce clock. It's coming soon.
Yeah, it's like whenever a couple gets like a joint Facebook account.
Right.
I think that's exactly what happened there, because it was literally not even a year later they got divorced. And I think that was a situation where it feels like, and look, this is me guessing, I don't know what happened, but doesn't it seem like something like he was caught cheating or something? And she was like, I want to leave you. And she goes, no, honey, you're so smart. I'll tell you what, you know, next special, we'll just use everything that you wrote. And she's like, okay, that's fine. But then he cheated on her again at the special. And then like, all right, you know, fuck you.
Because it's like, why not have her do the special?
Have you seen her lately? I wouldn't.
I don't know what you. I don't know anything about her, really.
Not great.
All right. Well, I'll do more research into that. So yeah, he's name dropping Dana White to get back to Schaub here.
Yeah.
And let's take name dropping out of it. Mm-hmm. Tell me if you just believe this story, because we do. He does know Dana White for all his name dropping. Of course, he interacts with him.
1,000%.
So he must have stories about him interacting with Dana White. I don't know if this actually happened, though.
I got a fight for you. MGM Grand, December 6th, number 2 guy in the world. Before I could even answer, he hangs up the phone. I'm like, well, all right. I thought, man, it's weird. I'm like 10 or 11. He's like number 2. Why would they give me this fight? He's better at everything than me. He's bigger. He's faster. He's stronger. What the fuck am I going to do?
So there's a lot to unpack here, as the kids say. First, the idea, this is my biggest problem with Schaub. Of course, you can exaggerate, you can straight up make things up in comedy, absolutely. But it can't be something that the audience can just see through blatantly.
Oh, of course.
And there's no situation where Dana White, UFC commissioner, would call him, say, I got a fight for you, here's a brief summary of some vague details, and hang up before he gets a chance to accept. That's just not how it works.
Yeah, I don't care how busy Dana White is. If he called you, he'd be like, is that, at least be like, is that cool, bro? And he'd be like, oh,
you
know,
if you have a vacation scheduled that week, anything.
Exactly, right? Like, what do you think? You know, instead it's just like, guess what? You're fighting, click. I don't think that's, for that, you could have texted him.
And this goes back to the, it kind of goes in a weird way. I can tie it back to the impression of the Asian doctor there, because essentially without knowing it, Brendan Schaub's impression of Dana White is that he's like a rude asshole. And Schaub is just saying, well, I can use that for the, I can use these people for my bits, even though nothing close to this happened.
Well, that part's probably true.
Dana White being an asshole.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, sure. Who knows? Maybe. But, well, okay. So the second thing,
I walk in, man, and Dana White's fucking Ronda Rousey on his desk, bro. I swear to God, man. Which, you know what? That might have also been true. Well, I don't know.
I think another thing I saw you guys cover, another clip that turned me onto your guys' show was when you guys broke down Schaub ratting out Rogan and Dana White for slinging dick.
Yeah, bro, what kind of bro is that? You know? Yeah.
What are you doing, man?
Dude, there's like fucking bro code, right? Like, you don't blow up somebody's fucking... Look, do I think Rogan's fucking a boy? Of course he is. Who wouldn't? He's the most popular guy in the goddamn world. Like, your buddy, the guy that gave you your fucking comedy career, you threw him under the bus?
You just say into a microphone, yeah, Rogan slings dick.
Like, come on,
married,
man.
With children.
You fucking asshole.
It's funny because his timeline is, I started comedy like 3 months ago. Rogan slings a lot of dick at the comedy club.
Right. Married for 12 years or something.
Yeah.
So my second issue with this clip, the one I really couldn't wrap my mind around is, and you guys got to tell me, because you know UFC a little better than I do. Mm-hmm. He goes, what is Dana White doing? This guy's ranked number 2 in the world. I'm ranked 10th. How is that a fair fight?
That's a favor for him, because if he wins, he's going to move way up in the ranking.
Of course. I was like, right.
Even if he loses and he puts up a good fight, he probably would still go up in the ranking depending on how he does in the fight. So he's in a pretty good situation, actually.
So, like, I don't know fighting, but like Michigan plays Appalachian State once in a while, you know, mismatches happen. The idea that you guys are both ranked in the top 10 is not a mismatch.
This is the most obvious thing to ever happen, because I don't think Brock Lesnar at any point in his life went, oh man, that guy's way bigger than me. He's getting a pound into the ground.
Can you imagine Brock Lesnar be like, oh, I don't know, I'm a little worried about this fight. Like, it's the UFC, right? Like, I get that there's a ranking system, but in reality, all of you are fucking professional fighters, right?
Animals. You could rip our heads off.
If you're in the same division, every one of you, you'd be ranked 20th, and the person could be ranked number 1. The 20th guy always has a chance if he knocks somebody out. Right, get him with a punch, right? So he's making it seem like, yeah, it's like, you know, it's like he's like a 5-year-old, and you're making him fight Mike Tyson. That's not what's happening. You're professional fighters.
That's be Rocky in this situation. Yeah. He's imagining us running behind him as he runs up the steps.
I would push him down the steps because I'm so sick of this. And you know, the other problem with Schaub is, if you watch his, we did this on our show recently, watch his early videos when he just started in the UFC, the way he talks and the way he talks now, like his brain is damaged. Like he's not old enough to be talking like Joe Biden, and he is, and it's weird. Yeah.
Well, you know what? I don't think I would even trash Schaub if, like, I look at Brendan Schaub and I say, the guy's been in stand-up for five to 7 years. I'm not exactly sure the timeline. Let's call it 5 years.
Right.
That's not enough time, like we talked about, to be a good stand-up with, like, real chops and stage presence. I wouldn't expect him to be that good. And, hey, if people are offering him theater gigs and Showtime specials, that's hard to turn down, so I understand it. You should, for the good of your career, but I understand it's hard to turn down. The reason I shit on Schaub is because when people make fun of him online, he goes out. I know you hate this guy, but who's the mushmouth kid?
I don't like that guy even a little bit. But we were the first ones to defend him and go,
yeah,
you can't be fucking suing people.
It's crazy. You can't do that. That turns us all against you, Brendan.
Yeah,
I don't care if the trolls.
I don't care if it's somebody that I completely despise.
Right.
If somebody like Brendan Schaub is going after a fucking content creator for fucking joking on him a little bit, and Ben Pixels hit us a couple times with copyright stuff, and we fought it and we won. So this has been going on for a while. But after we fucking embarrass him, they don't hit us with it anymore. But he took down Beige Frequency's documentary of him, like,
which was brilliant, by the way.
Great. Yeah, I'm like, take it on the chin, bro.
Yeah, seriously.
Yeah, and that, like we were talking about with Stuttering John, I just did a podcast on patreon.com/blindmike which you can subscribe to if you're not already. Get these episodes a week early. But I just did a quick episode talking about Carl's situation, and I was like, if Stuttering John just went on that podcast and shit on Carl or made fun of himself or whatever he wanted to do, he'd be beloved by that fan base. They'd carry him on their shoulders. They'd be chanting Stuttering John's name.
But he won't do it. He won't
never.
Do it. He won't do it because he thinks of himself bigger than he is. But it's like, listen, John, I've heard you on your show say you have to borrow your neighbor's Wi-Fi. You know, you told me you had roach problems in your house. You know, you basically let a hooker live with you. Like, I'm sorry, bud, but you're not living this extravagant lifestyle anymore. You're not Jay Leno's producer anymore.
And you know what? If you know, Blind Mike goes on, or Royce Lopez, or Craig goes on their podcast and says, I have fucking roaches in my house and my fingernails are dirty and all that shit, and we laugh about it, it's hard to make fun of us because we're bringing it up and accepting it. John's problem is he'll mention those things and give us a taste of that and then talk about how rich he is and how successful and famous he is. And it's like, dude, you're in denial. Self-awareness is what we're making fun of. It's got nothing to do with you as a guy.
The last time he performed in Tampa, he made, for the whole weekend, he made a net profit of $200.
Ooh, so
righteous bucks.
Just hey, so you know how much he's fucking big boys bringing in.
Pretty good.
Not bad.
All right, so Brendan is tasked with going up against a fighter that is slightly better than him. And let's see how he handles that amazing underdog story.
I would train so hard. I went MI from everybody. I did no interviews. I couldn't even text my family and friends at night. My hands were shaking so bad I trained. Couldn't text. A week before the fight, I felt so much pressure like never before. It was 1 a.m. I went to a 24-hour fitness to run these nerves off. Mind you, I didn't eat for the entire day because I was so nervous. I get on the treadmill. There's not many people there. It's kind of the weird situation at 1 a.m.
I would think not.
I'm running.
No, that's the time where most people go, actually. You didn't know that?
1 a.m, the gym wasn't packed. He calls it a weird situation.
Yeah, 1 a.m. is when the homeless people go to shower there.
I like the idea of a guy walking into the gym at 1 a.m, not seeing many people there, and going, well, this is an odd situation.
Oh, yeah, wow, they're sleeping, Brendan.
Where are my groupies here to greet me? Why isn't there my fan base? So he gets on the treadmill.
I'm on my back and I wake up. I can hear people going, hey, big man, get up. You all right, bro? Get up. I can hear them, but I can't see them. I went temporary blind for 24 hours.
But temporary. I went temporary blind.
I went. Yeah, well, it's not a great sentence structure.
I went blind temporarily. I was temporarily blind. Temporary blind.
Brendan, I'm full-time blind, you son of a bitch. How dare you complain about this?
I was going to say,
pickle the guile.
Go watch Gringo Poppy, folks.
Yeah. It's the best special.
By the way, while I'm thinking of that, have we promoted Revenge of the Sith enough? I'm sorry. Revenge of the Sith. You have another podcast too, right?
Yeah, Daywave. It's right behind me. That's my morning show. I do that from 10 a.m. to noon every day, Monday to Friday.
Go listen to both for more laughs like this. Royce is a hoot. All right, I want to finish this clip up. So he's passed out. He went temporary blind.
That is the end of it. Just so you know.
Oh, that was the end? I thought he had another bungling line after that. But
there's 1 second left, so you might be right.
I might be right.
Nope.
God damn it. I'm always good with these things. But yeah, he's again. I don't know that story happened. Like so maybe it did. Maybe he lost vision for a day or something because he fell on the treadmill. But all he says is, I was pretty tired. I went to the gym at 1 a.m. Probably not a great idea. He goes, I get on the treadmill and then all of a sudden I was temporarily blind.
I think the more realistic thing is,
Brendan, that's not a story.
Yeah, he was shitting his pants because Matt Brown was gonna fuck him up and he was trembling and he fell on his back and then he was embarrassed, so he went, oh, I can't see shit. That's what happened.
You got to give us a few more details. Paint a picture with words, Brendan. Jesus. What's the next clip?
Has Brendan never fought?
So Brendan's amazement at his opponent makes me wonder that. Like, when I hear this, I think, like, this is his last fight in the UFC. He's a veteran at this point. It's very odd that he's not used to these things.
It's finally the night of the fight. MGM Grand, Las Vegas. I'm in my locker room, and I'm warming up. I'm feeling good. And this is what they don't show on those behind the scenes, those 24/7s. There's my locker room, the blue corner, and my opponent's in the room next to me. What separates us, about 2 inches of drywall. I can hear everything. I hear everything. So I'm warming up, and I hear, wakdoom, wakdoom.
What separates locker rooms is not 2 inches of drywall. If you've ever been to a locker room, it's like a concrete wall.
It's a right. Cement steel reinforced mess that you can't hear.
I mean, every locker room I've seen anyway, right? Even for college sports, it's a concrete wall. It's first off, why would you put drywall in a humid locker room? Let's start with that. And no, you weren't. But the problem with him is that when Brendan tells you a story, to me, it's like when a 5-year-old tries to tell you a story, right?
Yes.
And then the guy was really big, and then I got scared, and then I fell. And then, are you listening to me? Yes. Are you listening? Yes. Okay. So, and then my friend Joe Rogan came, and he's big, and then I'm like, bro, Brendan, spit it out, retard.
Oh, he loves throwing out Rogan's name in this and things like that. Dana White, as we said, he loves telling you who his friends are, which is weird because then he creates this David versus Goliath story where we're supposed to believe little Brendan Schaub is shivering in his boots as this behemoth punches the wall next door.
Yeah, and Brendan, it's not like he's the gladiator or something. Like, fucking stop.
It's like, Brendan, I'm sure the guy is a monster. He's ranked second in the world. You're also an amazing fighter. Give yourself a little credit. You're 10th in the world. You're good at something. Talk about that.
Exactly.
Stick with that.
Let's hear the next clip. I think this might be post-fight, if I'm not mistaken.
This one has like 20 seconds left. I don't know if you want to move on still.
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry. No. Oh, that's right. We didn't hear the end result. His trainers... they try and calm him down from his fears.
Mm-hmm.
The fuck is that? They look at each other and go, that's your opponent in the midst, man. Oh, right. Like, you could do that. You could do that, man. Don't even worry about it. Yeah, we'll do it after. He's probably getting tired. Like, yeah, whatever you think, man.
So Brendan is, his opponent is the dog in the sandlot, and Brendan is just a little kid trying to get his ball back.
Oh my, and how long are people going to make a Brendan Schaub? Forever. Forever. Fucking Benny the Hack Rodriguez over here puts on his fucking PF flyers and bombs 5 times in a row, and they cut the special up, and then he goes, why do people think I suck? I don't fucking know, because you're an L7 weenie, probably.
I guess. I'm very impressed. 3 tags to my Sandlot records.
Thank you, man. I love
Sandlot. That's very impressive.
All right. Thank you. Thank you.
That's great. What's the next one?
The next one is front row.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, we're not after the fight yet. He's describing, I mean, talk about name dropping if you want to hear this. But he's describing... The more shivering in his boots, the fear that he feels. So, if you've ever seen a Vegas fight, often they'll show celebrities in the front row and things like that. First of all, I should have gone into the archives and found out if this was even true. But Brendan Schaub describes the front row of his big fight.
Yeah, my good friend Gandhi. You ever heard of him?
More into the front row, and I see Will Smith.
Sitting right next to Tupac Shakur's mom.
Shut up, Fresh Prince. What's up, man? Next to him, I see Ice-T. I'm like, what's up, Ice-T from Law and Order SUV, I guess.
I got to say, pause for a second. That is what annoys me so much about that is, like, Brendan Schaub is dumb and will mess up things like that in the special by accident.
Mm-hmm.
So to put in SUV that we all know, like, what's sad is imagining Brendan Schaub going to different comedy clubs and theaters and doing that and saying from Law and Order SUV.
And he probably did it over and over again.
over and over again. That's funny, right, guys? I'm dumb. No, we know.
We know. Brendan, buddy, we know you're dumb. You don't have to keep telling us.
It's all good, brother. We got message received.
We have ears, buddy. We know.
Don't focus so much on that. More about crafting a joke, perhaps.
Yeah. Stop leaning into how stupid you are.
So Ice-T from SUV is there. Who else?
I love that.
Wish it was Ice Cube, but what's up, T?
Oh, God.
Next to him, Leonardo DiCaprio, son. You're talking A-list. And he's with two dime pieces around his arm like this.
No, he's not.
No, he's not. Certainly not.
What?
No, he's not.
DiCaprio? Jack?
Pause again. Again, he is throwing a celebrity under the bus publicly.
Now, by the way, do I believe Leonardo DiCaprio there were two chicks? Of course I believe that, of course. But also, he's also an actor who's in the spotlight, so he wouldn't be sitting like a fucking rapper with two of his arms around the two chicks. He's probably sitting next to him. He's probably talking to them. But Leonardo DiCaprio also understands there's going to be cameras on him, so he's not going to be fingering one girl and making out with the other one like Brendan Schaub's describing here, you know? Yeah, so Leonardo DiCaprio's just face-fucking this broad. All right, bro.
The thing I'm focused on is, like, we know this is a fake story.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say DiCaprio, I'm sure he didn't based on his lifestyle.
Yeah.
But let's say he had a serious girlfriend at the time. Schaub is just throwing him under the bus because this girl is going to look at the timeline and be like, were you with two women at a UFC fight?
You told me you were making a movie.
Schaub doesn't realize the consequences of his lies.
He's just ruining lives. Schaub just has fucking a pile of ruined lives behind him because he's trying to be funny. And the problem is, would it be worth it if the jokes were killing? Of course it would be. But he's ruining lives and he sucks.
And bombing. Yeah,
exactly.
That would be a great... We're going to have to collaborate on an investigation. The butterfly effect of lives Brendan Schaub has ruined.
I'm telling you, bro. The fucking thick... The thick boy effect.
Thick boy effect. All right, so DiCaprio, well, that's a big name. To me, that's not the most interesting person in the front row.
Epstein there?
From Titanic? I've seen that 1,000 times, man. This is nuts. Fucking Jack's here to see me. This is nuts.
Sounds focused on the fight.
Next to him, I see my ex-girlfriend.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Like, well. Look what the cat drug in, huh? Couldn't get enough of the big man, huh? Enjoy the show, bitch.
That's not was funny. She, Brendan? Was she really?
Yes, and I'll tell you why. I'll tell you why.
Why?
Because he was dating Ronda Rousey, and she was then dating Travis Brown, his opponent.
Oh, is that true?
Yes.
Oh, I didn't say fucking Ronda Rousey. That's what. Now I'm even more mad because I'm listening to this story like, Brendan, the sheer odds that your girlfriend would be at this fight in the front row, that's impossible. He couldn't just say Brendan. Ronda Rousey?
Oh, fuck. Well, you know, that's my point with him, though. Even like you said, the timeline things again, it's like, and my girlfriend at the time, anyone would be like, oh, so Ronda Rousey, is that who you're talking about? Because that was your girlfriend at the time. Again, ruining lives for no reason.
The bit is funnier if he mentions Ronda Rousey.
Yeah, exactly.
He could make a joke about her beating the shit out of him or something. Just anything.
That's not really just like, let's not smash our heads trying to write his jokes better because it would be super easy. The problem with him is that, like you said, he's too wrapped up on him. He's too wrapped up in exaggerating. Look, if there's something you know about any UFC fighter, they all think they could win. And that's not something that they put on. Like anybody,
you have to.
Anybody who knows a top tier athlete, it doesn't even have to be fighting, right? NFL, NBA, anything like that. All of them, even the ones on the bench, think they are the best person there, and they could
fucking beat anybody, because that's the only way you become a professional fighter. You have to go, no fucking fear, I'll fight anybody. These fighters aren't scared. And if they were like that, they wouldn't be in the UFC. So that's the other thing. He's pretending. First off, Brendan's too stupid to be scared. You know, right. He's too dumb. Like, he doesn't sense fear.
Right. No.
So the problem, it's been a through line of everyone we've T.I. You saw it for sure with the situation. These guys don't have like a real perspective on their lives, which gives them, it makes it very difficult to straddle the line that they try to walk of, I'm the greatest in the world, and I also suck, right, everyone? I'm just like you guys. Like, he's trying to portray this, you know, this rough and tumble kid who's scared of the big fight. And also, like, fuck you, bitch, to his ex-girlfriend in the front row.
I know, it's like, first off, if you were that scared, you wouldn't be thinking like, oh, look who came to see me. First off, the only thing you're thinking when you're walking up, there's like thinking of your training, thinking of what you're going to do, try not to get hit in the head. I mean, that's pretty much, don't get taken down. You know, that's what you're thinking of when you're walking up there. You're not thinking of like, oh, look, Ice-T's here. Look at all of the, no, that's not what you're doing. And he exaggerates this thing because he's trying to be a multimillionaire UFC fighter every man. And that doesn't work. You can't be an elite athlete, a millionaire, and be fucking ham and egger, like a fucking, right. And that's what he's trying to mish together. And that doesn't work. Like, a good, you could be fucking super rich and be funny. Look at Ricky Gervais's new special. Guy's richer than fucking most, probably any comic, maybe except Chappelle, right? And more than him, because he created The Office.
Yeah, he's got to have a shit ton of money. Yeah.
Right. And he could be funny because you could be rich and lean into it. If you're good, you could be rich and lean into it. Like, one of my funniest jokes that Louis C.K. ever told to me was the special that somebody secretly recorded after the New York Times came out. He was working on new material.
Yep.
And one of the jokes that he told, he was like, you know, like, I don't really talk about how much money I make because making $40 million for a movie isn't funny. But he goes, after this New York Times things, losing $40 million is hilarious. And I'm like, there you go. He's a multimillionaire and he made it fucking funny, right?
Right.
But Brendan doesn't do that. He doesn't pick a fucking lane. Either I'm this badass, look how funny I am, or I'm a fucking down on my luck loser and they're picking on me. Let me go dox Bobby Lee's family. Like, all
right,
man.
Right. So, and the reason for that is because Louis C.K. was a self-deprecating, self-loathing guy for his entire life and then happened to get really famous and successful. So he still had that muscle that he could make fun of. Brendan Schaub, and neither personality type is right or wrong, in my opinion. Brendan Schaub was wired to do a totally different thing. He's wired to beat the snot out of people.
Right, of course.
And pulverize people. And for that, you need a tremendous amount of confidence. So you can't be the self-deprecating guy. You got to find a different angle, which is hard for a guy like Brendan.
Yeah, no, he's not. I mean, I think you're right on that. You're 100% right on that. Like, you're right. Some people are wired a certain way. And
right.
I think it's very rare, right, to be able to be really good at one thing and really good at another thing. Most people are really good at one thing, right? Like, I am good. I specialize my whole life. If you grew up your entire life and you've been training MMA and jujitsu and that's in your brain and your brain becomes wired and you're the coolest guy in your class and that's who you are and you're a badass.
Right.
It's very hard when you're in your mid-30s to go, oh, I'm going to try to wire my brain to be a comic now. And it's like, it doesn't work. It's
no. There's three, like, you mentioned Donald Glover earlier, and the reason he's so impressive is because he's able to do five things. You know, he's a writer, actor, rapper, comedian.
I think
he's able to do all those tremendously. There's not a lot of Donald Glovers out there, and Schaub certainly isn't one of them.
No, there's not. But here's the other thing. Even with Donald Glover, you go, well, he stayed in entertainment.
Right. Right.
And I'm not – that's hard,
too. That's a great point, too. Yeah, you're right.
But at least Donald Glover stayed in music, you know, TV, comedy,
you know. It's the same mind, the same type of creative mind.
It takes, like, you know, there's a lot of good stand-ups that are also really good comedy writers, right? Like a lot of people, I don't mean to keep bringing up Louis C.K., but he's just a great example. Louis, you don't know how much stuff Louis C.K. wrote that he's never been in. Like the guy's a good writer. Sure. So I think you could, if that, there's a comedic mindset, but going from like, that's like if fucking Bo Jackson's like, guess what guys, I'm a comic now. You'd be like, no, you're not.
Yeah.
You know?
Right.
You are not.
All right. So spoiler alert, Brendan Schaub loses. I hope no one was on the edge of their seat for that.
No, no, he's a loser. So I figured.
So let's hear the next clip.
Yeah, it's this one and then one more, but the last one's long.
Perfect.
I keep going, and then just the boo birds right now. I'm getting popcorn thrown at me. I'm like, oh my God. In the corner of my eye, I see this mom with her two kids.
She has some big pause for a second. I'm sorry. Hey, go back to the beginning of that clip if you could.
You guys are a lot like us, man. We pause a lot too.
Oh, this is you this can't is not even it. Half of it. We no, watched an episode of Quincy the other day, and it took us 3 hours.
That happened to me too. A 10-minute clip, I do an hour on it. Yeah, but you know that's the way it works.
So fucking Schaub is so he loses the fight. Mm-hmm. He's again portraying. We have evidence. Craig, you might know better than me. I couldn't find the fight or anything. Mm-hmm. Were people throwing popcorn at him after he lost?
That I don't recall, but I hope so.
Like is that a usual thing at UFC that they're fucking like harassing the loser?
No, they'll boo the shit out of you, but they won't throw shit at you typically.
You're not gonna, well, you'll get kicked out too. Like, okay. I don't think throwing stuff at people sounds like something that would happen at an ECW show in 1996.
Yeah, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm going too far in accusing him of lying on that one, but it just seems like something that wouldn't happen. but he's setting it up with the reason I'm skeptical, and this I think this ruins your entire set as a stand-up. If the audience thinks you're lying, because that's all you're focused on. You're like, well, you're saying untrue things, Brendan. So why? I'm not going to laugh at this anymore. You're taking me out of it.
Well, you're right. It's not even like comedians embellish. Obviously, that's part of the gig. But the problem is that you're embellishing the setup, which you don't need to. Like, you can embellish the punchline, of course. I mean, everyone does that. But you're factually stating something that I could go look up right now. Yes, exactly. Like even if you're a comic and you are going to lie, you can if it's not on fucking national TV.
Right. If it's, hey, I was at Starbucks and this happened this morning, you know?
Of course. No one's going to go, okay, that makes sense. People go to Starbucks. But it's like, Brendan, your fight was on TV. 20 million people saw it. Like, you can't now go, oh, yeah, it was this way. I'm like, no, it's not, man. Nobody was throwing popcorn at you. I don't believe you.
It's wild, which is why even if this happened, which seems far-fetched to me, I really don't believe the story he's about to tell about this woman that he sees.
No.
I keep going, and then just the boo birds right now, I'm getting popcorn thrown at me. I'm like, oh, my God. In the corner of my eye, I see this mom with her two kids. She has some big-ass titties. She's like this. I'm like, God, I could use a hug. I go in for a hug, and her son, who couldn't be more than 13, goes, "Ew, mom, don't hug him. He's a loser."
I'm a loser. Like the dumb fucking audience.
Fuck you, bro.
He's got potential. That's the saddest thing.
So he walked into the audience and hugged somebody.
I don't even understand. You saw a woman with big.
Is that on video? Because I would love to see if that happened. That feels like that would be something that would be on video.
It would have been a viral clip. It would have been a viral clip. Brendan Schaub, all fucking sweaty and bloody and beat up, walks into the audience and hugs a woman.
Oh, I actually have apparently ESPN hot woman. I have ESPN Plus now, so I'm gonna dig.
Please do.
Because this is something that he should be called out for too. Oh, so I could use a hug. Shut up. Why are you lying? What was the joke? And why are people laughing? What's happening? Like, there's people laughing, and mostly the people that I hear laughing are women. Do you notice that? It felt like it was more women laughing than dudes. And that's because chicks just want to fuck a UFC fighter. You know, and that makes sense.
I think that's a lot of, I think Brendan Schaub and Chris D'Elia's audience are like, you know, frat bros that just want to fucking party and aren't fans of comedy.
If it's Chris D'Elia, it's also probably high schoolers, but I hear you.
One of our great patrons, our boy Visionalist Dave. Yeah. I talk about D'Elia all the time, and I always say, like, he has fans. I don't understand. He has fans. Like, he has genuine fans. I'd love to, like, get a D'Elia fan on and just interview them. Like, what is it about it that lead you to this guy.
Douchebag and, culture, bro. You brought it up earlier. It's exactly going back to what you said earlier. Yeah. It's this frat boy douchebag. Right. And by the way, and I'm not saying all of them because I really don't like Penny, but a lot of LA comics that I've watched cater to douchebags. Like,
sure.
They cater to, like, you know, Brian Callen does that too, where he's like, yeah, definitely, you know,
yeah,
like, you know, we made fun of Brendan Schaub and Brian Callen. They made fun of us back. One of the few shows that they actually said something about us. Like, yeah, these two fucking losers, you know, they come on and, you know, they don't look like they work out or crush puss or play a sport.
Oh, God. And then, see, I was about to say, well, that's what they should do. They should go after you guys.
Yeah.
But not in that way. Like, what the fuck are you doing?
But then we replied to them laughing. We're like, is that all you guys think of? Is you think if you're getting pussy and dunking a basketball, that's what makes you cool? Like,
we're podcasters.
I know, we're podcasters. We're
in the podcast universe. I'm a dumpy guy in a hat, fucking beard, and a black T-shirt or a gray T-shirt.
All of us are wearing the same uniform right now. We're wearing the official podcast uniform.
I feel attacked right now.
Yeah, you and me both. Look, we're all wearing our official podcast uniform. And right. That's my point. It's like, this isn't about being cool, guys. This isn't about how much puss you crush, dude.
Yeah.
It's the fact that you're not funny. And it's okay to be not funny. I don't get mad at people for not being funny. I'm not mad at Brendan for trying. I'm not mad at Brendan for taking the money. I'm not mad at Brendan for making the special. I am mad at how fucking arrogant he is about it, because yes, he think he earned it. If you're right, you could take the money, but you know what you are then? You're humble as shit, right?
Yeah.
You're humble because, by the way, his little story, he's Mr. Little Humble Brendan. How come I never see that humble Brendan? Where's that guy? You know, the only time Brendan cries is when he goes, they're bullying my family, I'm gonna murder Bobby Lee.
Well, it's a lot like I know you guys make fun of Opie as well, I'm sure.
Oh, he's easy to make fun of.
So the big problem, and Norton would point this out a lot. What's up?
It's a great guy, that Opie Hughes.
Something Norton points out a lot is Opie's lack of self-awareness, where he'll throw out there, he's like, yeah, I know I got problems. I try to take care of my shit. But then you don't do that. You don't actually acknowledge you have problems. So I could easily say, like, oh yeah, I'm not that great either, but never work on myself.
Yeah, no, Opie's great. I'm actually the, one of my really good friends is E-Rock.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, like we go way back, like years and years and years. So E-Rock's my good buddy, and that all made me hate Opie even more. Like, he fucked people.
Yeah,
Opie fucked people
after them being loyal for forever.
He went behind the fucking scenes and he complained about everybody to HR. Every single fucking person.
It's wild.
And
you know, everyone. What? We might have to have you on for an Opie episode.
Yeah, no, dude, I would love to. I know a lot about him and all the that entire fucking thing. I mean, I was on Opie and Anthony once, and I was on Ron and Fez twice.
Okay.
So I've been to the Sirius XM studio and shit like that. And Opie is an unmitigated prick.
How long have you guys been
Revenge of the Sis has only been around for 5-6 years, but
okay,
I've been doing podcasting for like 13 years, like, but before you could even like stream on YouTube, you know, when you had to just record it and upload it to fucking Apple.
Right.
You know?
Oh, I've
been doing it for a really long time.
I forgot. To get back to my point, Brendan Schaub has that thing where he tries to be self-deprecating and say, like, oh, yeah, like, I was scared, I was nervous. But in reality, he's not at all self-deprecating. He thinks he's the shit. He thinks he crushes puss. So you should play to that. Like, yeah, that's what you should play to is, you know, guys that like crushing pussy and partying.
Yeah, exactly.
So go ahead and play to that. Don't try and be us, you know?
Yeah, go the Dane Cook route.
Right.
You'd be the frat boy comic for a year, and then everybody forgets about you. Then you start dating an 18-year-old girl you met at a game night.
Sure. Yeah.
Normal stuff.
Don't insult Dane Cook in front of Craig. He gets very sensitive.
He's good. No. Is he?
Yeah.
So, you said we have one more clip left?
Yeah. This one's 2 minutes long.
All right. So, buckle up. Stop. You feel free to pause wherever you want, Royce. Tell us to pause.
Oh, no. Please go ahead. I love this stuff.
Okay.
My head's in my hands. The adrenaline from the fight wears off. The numbing pain from my lip wears off, and it hits me for the first time in my life ever. You will never be world champion. This is it for you. And I wish I could stay in front of you guys and say, I shed one like North Korean tear and moved on. Like, no, man, my big ass was howling at the heavens. I was howling, crying.
I'll give him, this is what I'll give him. I didn't love the joke that he made, but like, this is an interesting story to hear a guy after he just got the shit kicked out of him realize, like, I'm done. First, yeah,
he should have felt that way after the Showtime special, though. Why wasn't he humble after that? I would have been.
Well, first of all, Royce, I hate to keep picking at this thing. It didn't happen.
No.
As we all know, the reason his special is named You'd Be Surprised is because he went on Rogan, started talking about a rematch, and Rogan said, do you really think you could take this guy? And Schaub said, I think you'd be surprised. And Rogan said, really? Because I think you'd be surprised.
I remember that. That was one of my favorite back and forths ever.
That's why the special is called You'd Be Surprised. And he still lies about his thought process and says immediately after the fight, I was like, I'm done. Fuck. It didn't happen. But because also,
he wants to have a sitting on a stool deep moment, you know?
Yeah. But I'll give him this, at least as far as storytelling, like with this part, he's got me. But this is where you shouldn't be on Comedy Central. You shouldn't be on Showtime because you haven't developed the ability to take that interesting story and then craft a punchline after
that. That story is a great story to tell on your podcast.
Exactly.
That's not a stand-up comedian joke. Right. That shouldn't even be a joke. That should be like you're talking one day and you're doing a UFC, an MMA podcast, right? Which he does. Doing an MMA podcast, being like, that was the day I figured I was done. And you'd be like, oh, that's a cool story. This fighter's talking about, you know, and I would be like, oh, that's pretty cool. Right. Like, I wouldn't have this resentment. But the fact that you're telling this is a funny story on Comedy Central, you're like, OK, but this isn't the fucking place for that. Like this is a story you tell when you're on fucking, like I said, some sort of MMA podcast.
Rogan,
yeah.
Go tell it on Rogan where you did realize that your career was done.
Yeah, exactly.
I would love more than anything for him to tell this story on Rogan.
Joe would be like, the puzzled face that Rogan would make at that would be beautiful.
Like, he doesn't have the heart to destroy him anymore.
He probably just was like, sure, Brendan, man, whatever. All right, dude, sure.
Let's keep going.
My coach is like, we're not equipped to deal with this. They laugh. Way to go, guys.
It's literally their job.
Yep.
And I'm so exhausted from crying and there's snot. And I find myself on the ground in the fetal position. I look like a jumbo shrimp. I'm just on the ground, snot bubbles, tears. I want to stay there for the rest of my life. People leave, shut the lights out. There's like a janitor. I'm still there crying. And in walks, I see out of corner of my eye, a pair of sandals walks in. It's my best friend and partner in crime, Brian the Kid Callen. He walks up.
Pause. I hate to, again, another spoiler alert. I hate to keep spoiling this for people. He credits Brian Callen instead of Rogan.
I thought they were so bizarre. I didn't think they became friends till after this.
I don't even know. Maybe they were friends before, whatever.
Could have been. I mean,
they very well could have been. But we all know that Rogan is the reason he stopped fighting. He again lies about the people in his life and these very famous people that we all know and just credits Callen, which again, I think Schaub is like a simple guy. I don't think he's a bad guy necessarily. And I think in his mind there, he's like, I want to credit my boy, Brian Callen, but he doesn't realize how easy it is to pick that apart.
Well, you know what? I would just say one thing to that. I would normally agree with you. I don't think he's a bad guy. I would agree with you. I don't think he's a bad guy even 6 months ago. But after all the shit he did to Bobby Lee and after now,
you know what? That's people, true too.
Now my mind is changed. Now I'm like, okay, now you're being malicious, dude. Now instead of, look, you know what a really good comic would do? This being made fun of, if you're a good comic, you'd be like, fuck you. I'm going to make fun of you back. You know, watch how funny I am. I'm going to own all you assholes. But he can't do that. He's not capable of it. So the only thing he could do is cry and, you know, fucking start a goddamn international incident with fucking Bobby Lee.
The conclusion we kind of came, I'd be curious to get your take on this, actually. Yeah. The conclusion we kind of came to after listening to all the Tiger Belly shit, we broke it all down. And what I said was, Craig thought Kalila was lying about the whole thing, which I don't want to get into.
Nah, fuck Kalila too, by the way. She's
I don't want to get into right now. But my point was, I don't think Brendan was necessarily lying about anything, which kind of absolves him of being a bad guy. I think he's just a very gullible guy. And I put the blame on Callan, who they literally said was threatening Bobby Lee.
Oh, Callan's fucking nuts. But here's the problem, though. The next episode of Tiger Belly, Bobby Lee's producer came on and he said, they said they were going to give us all this paperwork on how, and they didn't. Yep. So then I'm like, okay, so now you're being shady again, right? Like, let's put
this now we know you're lying, Brendan. Where is that? How do you avoid that? How do you not address? And did he ever go on his podcast and say, hey, I know, guys, I said I would show the Tiger Belly guys this paperwork, but here are the reasons I can't.
He did say he did say that he would show them, not give it to them. He did say that.
But right. He didn't do that.
Yes, he showed them.
No. He showed them one piece of paper that had an HTML.
He showed them like, but zoomed in screenshots.
Right. And they go, okay, but you know, you need, what are you talking about? You have like, say you have 600 pages. What do you mean?
Yeah. Like this says robertlee@gmail.com.
Yeah.
That's all you're showing me. You're not showing what document it's on.
Yeah, Mike, to your point though, I think that's though that adds to your theory that Schaub is just gullible. He's probably like,
that's what I truly believe, is that he's just a dummy.
I think you're right. I think that makes sense. I think because that Bobby Lee invited Schaub back on his podcast, but Bobby Lee won't even mention Brian Callen's name, because Brian Callen was absolute, and Brian Callen is a hothead. We've covered this for years, but Brian Callen is somebody who admits, like, you'll fucking fight somebody in a club, you'll punch somebody. He gets aggro like real fucking quick. Sure,
yeah.
Like, he does kind of have an anger issue. I also have somebody that defended Brian Callen against those quote unquote rape allegations. I don't think he raped anybody. I think that bitch is a liar, especially when you follow back the story and then you fucking find out who these people are.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you though, like, this story almost made me wonder about that. Not that I have no evidence in either direction, really.
Mm-hmm.
But like, after hearing he threatened Bobby Lee physically and all that, Bobby Lee's a guy, he's fucking 4'11". Like, he's a tiny guy.
Exactly. Yeah.
So to physically threaten him does make me wonder, like, you know what? Who the fuck knows what happened, you know?
Right.
Anyway, let's come to a merciful end on this clip, for God's sakes.
The old uppercut, huh?
What Callan said to him, apparently.
He puts his hand out, he picks me up. I look at him and go, I don't think this is for me anymore, man. He looks around and goes, I don't think it's for anybody.
So hold on, just to point something out. This is important. I think this is important. The funniest thing he said all night was a joke Brian Callan said.
Right.
I just want to really put things in perspective here. The funniest thing he said this entire thing was a joke that Brian Callen said.
Right. Yeah, let me tell you guys something a comedian friend of mine said. would it be nice to have a comedian up here tonight?
But, yeah, seriously. All right. I'm bringing, you know who picked me up from the floor? My good friend, great comedian, T.I.
So,
he said, yo, homie, don't trip.
Keep in mind, this is a show that was started by Ari. I don't know if you're an Ari Shaffir fan or not.
I fucking love Ari Shaffir.
If anyone is for complete fuckery, like just complete nonsense. No,
Amazing Racist alone.
Yes.
He's the GOAT for that. He did shit that right now, like if you tried that now, you would fucking be sent to fucking Gitmo. And he fucking is hilarious. He's also a genuinely, he doesn't lie. Like, he's a dude that only has a fucking flip phone. He's the other one that, did you hear the story about when he did the lie detector test on Luis J. Gomez's show?
Oh, I watched it, yeah. When they asked him if Brendan Schaub was funny.
Yeah, dude, that fucking, I bet Luis is one of my, one of the people that I respect the most. Luis is one of those people that, first people that actually let us like on his like show and stuff.
We
flew up to New York and stuff. And yeah, because you know, Luis is kind of dude's like, dude, just come on, man. I don't give a shit. Because a lot of people are like, oh, Revenge of the Sith, they're edgy and they're going to get us in trouble. And he's like, I don't give a fuck. Like, I'll interview anybody.
Yeah, so, he's been very good to me and very limited interaction. He's been
he's nuts. He will himself admittedly nuts, but he's
sure.
Really is a good dude. But yeah, that lie detector thing, like that's that Brendan Schaub, like right there, like that's why I like
Ari Shaffir when he asked him, like, do you feel bad for that Kobe joke? He's like, no. And then, like, the lie detector said he really doesn't feel bad. Like, I mean, what are you going to do?
The only reason I bring that up is it's amazing to me, like, Brendan Schaub's instincts. This is a show created by Ari Shaffir, who is just, like, the ultimate troll. He just loves fucking around. This was his show. And Brendan Schaub goes on it. And this is how he ends this story on a comedy show.
And from that day on, I've never stepped foot in a ring again, and I found my true calling. I'm on Comedy Central. I can't thank Justin, Eric, everyone. Ari, for giving me this chance. I love you guys. I will never forget this. Thank you.
That's it.
That was his closing joke?
That's it.
Jesus. Hey,
after all that, he ends with, thanks.
That's my time was taken?
I guess so. It's very bizarre to me. Now, we could argue, is that as bad as the Gringo Poppy closer? It's hard to say.
What's the deal with marriage, y'all?
How many of y'all married?
How many of y'all married, y'all? How many of y'all married?
Oh, my God. Well, I think we've about said it all on Brendan Schaub, but...
Yes, that was fun, man.
Make sure, for God's sake, make sure you go listen to the Revenge of the Sis podcast. And what's the other show you do? I'm sorry, I said it already.
Daywave Radio.
Daywave Radio, for the love of God. And you can find that where?
Just YouTube, man. Just search for Daywave Radio. It'll come up. And Revenge of the Sis. Just search for Revenge of the Sis. It'll come up. Perfect. And just find our stuff. We're a bunch of stupid assholes. Your fans will like us.
Yeah, like I said, if you guys like the shit we do on Patreon, where we just shit on comedy, where we watch... If you put it this way, if you enjoyed us watching Tom Myers... or an episode of Quincy, then I think you'll like these. These guys will be up your alley. So go listen to Revenge.
You guys, yeah, come on. You know, every month I'm gonna invite you guys on. We do a Patreon riff every month of, like, a really shitty movie. Like this month, okay, we just did the 2016 Ghostbusters, the all female one. Oh, yeah, we do really shitty movies. So if you guys ever want to come on and riff one of those, you're more than welcome.
We do the same shit with TV. So
that'll be fun.
I would love to. And I can tell already Craig will fit right in with you boys beautifully.
Awesome.
All right, buddy. Royce Lopez, thanks for coming on. Go follow him everywhere. Listen to Revenge of the Sis. If you like us, if you want to get Patreon episodes a week early, as well as TV Time Capsule, like I just mentioned, and extra episodes of the Blind Mike Project and all of that, go to blindmike.net. You can find all our links there. Patreon.com/blindmike. Also, subscribe to Craig's Patreon. patreon.com/verygoodshow, and go listen to Very Good Show as well.
Thanks.
All right, everybody, we'll talk to you guys next week.